Do you remember when we went to school? We heard about the enormous similarity between the breast and the prostate, and that was the end of the meaning. Nobody came up with an explanation. Similarity in what? Benign, malignant diseases? Well, if you use the farmer's common sense, then you could say, it is certainly true that both of them are fluid-producing organs. And the fluid is produced in the glands. We call it acini. And if there is fluid produced, it better come out. So there must be a duct too. And there has to be a hole. There is a tremendous similarity. Dear colleagues, here are the fingers or acini in the breast, three-dimensional histology. And likewise, of course, no surprise, here it is in the prostate. And the duct that leads the fluid out is here in the breast and the prostate. Most wonderful picture, three-dimensional. These are from the breast. This is the milk factory. And I really admire these acini within which the cells are producing the milk out of blood. And then the milk ends up in the subsegmental duct, major ducts, and then the baby is happy. Once again, the three-dimensional histology shows that the lobules have a large number of acini because the surface of the rubber gloves inside is much, much larger than the surface of the inner wall of a cyst. Larger surface, larger number of cells, more milk. Here is the conventional and the magnification of the conventional histology image, the basement membrane, myoepithelial cells, and the cells that produce the milk. Sometimes things can go wrong. Mind you, here is an acinus normally, but now it's as distended as this one. That is, there are these long metaplastic cells, apocrymetaplasia, and these cells become long and they don't do anything else but produce a large amount of fluid, which increases the intraluminar pressure, distends and distorts the acinus, and of course no woman can be happy about the end result, namely this cloudy, ugly, greenish, grayish fluid squeezed out of the nipple. But here are these acini that are cystically dilated. A part of this is the ducts. The ducts are pleated. Now, the pleated duct means that it has the ability of distending. Yeah, you can ask the question, where is the milk stored? Most of the milk is stored within the ducts. If we are thinking about cancer, when the cancer cells accumulate and they are lining up and proliferate tightly packed over each other, we call it solid cell proliferation. The intraluminar pressure is increasing, and they die into the lumen, then there will be a bar of necrotic tissue within which the radiologist, unfortunately a little bit too late, find the calcification. That is, this cancer was originating within the duct, ductal adenocarcinoma of the breast. It's picked up too late. And then we could talk a lot about the twisted nature of the pleats on the ducts and their branches. And that has, again, a function. Namely, that is the reason why the fluid gushing out from the terminal ductal lobular unit produced by the apocrymetaplastic cells is not coming out through the opening in the nipple, but going to be collected as breast cysts. Otherwise, poor middle-aged women would have dripping nipples. Here it is, dear colleagues, a normal resting pleated duct measures about 0.1 millimeter. Now this one is 30 times wider. These TDLUs were feeding in too much fluid, and that fluid contains a highly proteinaceous material, but Mother Nature takes the water back, and eventually this fluid is getting more and more concentrated. Let me call it a guacamole. Enjoy the three-dimensional histology images of the distended ducts and the distended and distorted TDL use. Here is the galactographic mammographic presentation of this. Similar thing might happen in the prostate. This is the normal prostate tissue. But tell me, which one is breast and which one is prostate? So when the fluid production takes place either within the breast or in the glands of the prostate, but they cannot come out, stagnate in the acini, then you got this very similar three-dimensional histologic image. Which one is breast? Which one is prostate? Indistinguishable. Now I'm filling in the sentence that there is a similarity between breast and prostate. And then when the fluid is stagnating in these distended areas, then we call it amyloid bodies, very concentrated protein, which actually attracts to itself the calcium, and eventually we are going to talk about prostate calculi. Dear colleagues, here is a total prostatectomy specimen, three-dimensional histology image. This little one is on the black and white specimen of the prostate is here, and that little one is here, this big one is here, and this big one is here. We can correlate very nicely, and I haven't shown you cells yet. When he has most of the prostate full of cystic changes, then he certainly has voiding problems. Especially when also benign prostate hyperplasia as well as cysts are plaguing him. Here are the amyloid bodies and then the calcified amyloid body, the prostate calculi. Actually, they are very nice laminated calcifications, oyster pearl-like, onion ring-like, in the breast. It's called summoma body-like calcifications, non-calcified and calcified in the prostate. But then, here is the breast. Exactly the same type of calcifications. And we call it powdery, cotton ball-like calcifications. Doodling determines the site of origin. We know exactly that this is within the lobule, terminal ductal lobular unit. So you see the prostate and the breast, the summoma body-like calcifications in the breast and the summoma body-like calcifications in the prostate. Let's go over to carcinoma. Is there any similarity between the cancer in the prostate and in the breast? Can you distinguish these two specimens? Hardly. Can you distinguish this one from this? This one is breast cancer. This one is prostate cancer. When we go down to the cellular level, you cannot make the difference. Amazing. Now we are filling in that sentence that there is a similarity. However, when I was doing prostate cancer research, I was positively shocked by the reports. The prostate expert pathologist calls the cancer originating from the cells lining the acini in the prostate acinar adenocarcinoma of the prostate. I just love that. They do not fool around with terms tubular, lobular, bubular, ductal, whatnot. No, straight and correct. Right on target. The cells within the duct developed cancer, and they call it ductal adenocarcinoma of the prostate. Now, why is this causing enthusiasm? Because these immediately have a lot to do with the long-term outcome. Long-term patient outcome is closely correlated with the terminology. Now, that's what I call modern medicine. That is, if it is a DAP, then you can count on the clinical picture. A man comes with a backache and very strange clinical symptoms, and the medical profession is going to find the primary cancer in the prostate. And you may be surprised that the PSA is not very high, if at all high. And you may be surprised, and I'm really looking forward to Dr. Barron's lectures. Could MR help in these cases? Or do we have to do more research? But on the other hand, the nice little sympathetic old grandpa is sitting on his prostate cancer for years. That originates from the acini. Of course, just like in breast cancer, the saga of screening is that we arrest those that are stellate and circular, that is originating from a terminal ductal lobule unit, and we prevent advanced cancer. Now, if the prostate or the breast cancer goes too far, that is, becomes advanced, stage 2, 3, 4, it might cause harm. But we can arrest it. Question, can we really find DIP early enough? So you understand my enthusiasm about the terminology, because patients really don't care about the MR image, histology, whatever we say. They are only caring about one thing: am I going to see my grandchildren grow up? Without good prediction of long-term outcome, what is the meaning of a conference? So on the other extreme, both the breast and the prostate develop these cancers that originate from the cells within the duct. There is a high fatality rate, according to literature, regardless of the therapeutic regimens. That was an epiphany for me, because I came to prostate cancer research from breast cancer, where there is a Babel's Tower. We don't understand each other, but in the prostate, it's pretty clear. AAP and DAP. So the origin of the prostate cancer is reflected in the terminology. Brilliant. Yes, it is. Here is the literature for you. According to Dr. Millis, most DIPs have a fairly aggressive course, high Gleason score. At radical prostatectomy, they are large, advanced, early recurrence, high risk. Dear colleagues, here is a case for you. It truly is invasive because it already invaded the muscles of the urinary bladder. It looks like in situ. It actually is duct-forming invasive carcinoma, infiltrating the muscle, infiltrating the fat, and actually drilling itself into the vessels, and you see a whole bar of duct full of carcinoma. And he has a backache, and he was dead half a year later. So on the basis of a 110 total prostatectomy specimen, we could confirm what the literature otherwise teaches us: significantly higher frequency of very advanced cancers, positive surgical margin, extracapsular extension, biochemical local recurrence, and many deaths. We published this. Dear colleagues, here is the result. 110 total prostatectomy specimen outcome. The patients with these prostatectomy specimen have this difference, DAP and AAP. So then I thought it would be very important to go back to the breast and straighten out the problem there as well. And using the terms we learned in the prostate, we could just say acinar adenocarcinoma of the breast and ductal adenocarcinoma of the breast. Would it be much simpler? Yes, because this reflects the site of origin, the cells within the fingers, the acini, and the cells within the ducts, which tells me that when pathologists are saying, by seeing, slicing, and diagnosing a circular, ill-defined, or stellate lesion, invasive ductal carcinoma, I'd like to send out a warning signal. Fear the word ductal. Dear colleagues, do you know what Luciano Pavarotti died from? Pancreatic cancer. In the pancreas, 95% of the cancers originate from the ducts. That's why pancreatic cancer is uncontrollable. Do you know what Steve Jobs died from? He died of a pancreatic cancer, but he didn't need to die because he got the 5%. His cancer was not ductal origin. Unfortunately, he delayed diagnosis. So, if we delay diagnosis in the breast, originating from the asinine, if we delay diagnosis and treatment in the prostate, originating from the gland, the outcome may be dismal. But never as dismal as when the cancer originates from the ducts. Parotid cancer, pancreatic cancer, prostate cancer, and breast cancer of ductal origin have high fatality. That's where I want to set the stage at this course at the beginning. Enjoy the three-dimensional histology of the breast. You don't need to be a physician to understand that this is a duct and its branches, subsegmental and larger, and these are the acini. We call it lobules, or together with the terminal duct, it's called terminal ductal lobular unit. Already at this time point, I'd like to set the stage by saying 75% of the breast cancers originate from the milk factory. What's the percentage in prostate? 90. If you use three-dimensional histology, then you establish that 10% of the prostate cancers are ductal origin and 90% are acinar origin. 25 and 75 in the breast. But there is a bad news here, namely 40% of the breast cancers are unifocal, but that hardly happens in the prostate. Prostate cancers in 95 plus percent of the cases are multifocal.